Part 2. Erik had a wife, who was named Thjóhild, and two sons. The one was named Thorstein, and the other Leif. These sons of Erik were both promising men. Thorstein was then at home with his father, and there was at that time no man in Greenland who was thought of so highly as he. Leif had sailed to Norway, and was there with King Olaf Tryggvason. Now, when Leif sailed from Greenland during the summer, he and his men were driven out of their course to the Sudreyar. They were slow in getting a favorable wind from this place, and they stayed there a long time during the summer, reaching Norway about harvest tide. He joined the bodyguard of King Olaf Tryggvason, and the king formed an excellent opinion of him, and it appeared to him that Leif was a well-bred man. Once upon a time, the king entered into conversation with Leif, and asked him, Dost thou propose sailing to Greenland in summer? Leif answered, I should wish so to do, if that is your will. The king replied, I think it may well be so. Thou shalt go my errand and preach Christianity in Greenland. Leif said that he was willing to undertake it, but that, for himself, he considered that message a difficult one to proclaim in Greenland. But the king said that he knew no man who was better fitted for the work than he. And thou shalt carry, said he, good luck with thee in it. That can only be, said Leif, if I carry yours with me. Leif set sail as soon as he was ready. He was tossed about a long time at sea, and lighted upon lands of which before he had no expectation. There were fields of wild wheat, and the vine tree in full growth. There were also the trees which were called maples, and they gathered of all this certain tokens. Some trunks so large that they were used in house building. Leif came upon men who had been shipwrecked, and took them home with him, and gave them sustenance during the winter. Thus did he show his great munificence and his graciousness when he brought Christianity to the land and saved the shipwrecked crew. He was called Leif the Lucky. Leif reached land in Eirik's Fjordr and proceeded home to Brattahlid. The people received him gladly. He soon after preached Christianity and Catholic truth throughout the land, making known to the people the message of King Olaf Tryggvason, and declaring how many renowned deeds and what great glory accompanied this faith. Erik took coldly to the proposal to forsake his religion. But when his wife, Thjóhild, promptly yielded and caused a church to be built not very near the houses, the building was called Thjóhild's Church. In that spot she offered her prayers, and so did those men who received Christ, and they were many. After she accepted the faith, Thjóhild would have no intercourse with Erik, and this was a great trial to his temper. After this, there was much talk about making ready to go to the land which Leif had discovered. Thorstein, Eirik's son, was chief mover in this, a worthy man, wise and much liked. Erik was also asked to go, and they believed that his luck and foresight would be of the highest use. He was for a long time against it, but did not say nay. When his friends exhorted him to go, they made ready the ship which Thorbjorn had brought there, and there were 20 men who undertook to start in her. They had little property, but chiefly weapons and food. On the morning when Erik left home, he took a little box, which had in it gold and silver. He hid the money, and then went forth on his journey. He had proceeded, however, but a little way, when he fell from his horse, and broke his ribs and injured his shoulder, and cried out, "Aya!" At this accident, he sent word to his wife that she should take away the money that he had hidden, declaring his misfortune to be a penalty paid on account of having hid the money. Afterwards, they sailed out of Eriksfjordr with gladness, as their plan seemed to promise success. They were driven out for a long time on the open sea, and came not into the track which they desired. They came in sight of Iceland, and also met with birds from the coast of Ireland. Then was their ship tossed to and fro on the sea. They returned about harvest tide, worn out by the toil and much exhausted, and reached Eirik's fjordr at the beginning of winter. Then spake Eirik, "You were in better spirits in the summer, when you went forth out of the firth, than you are now. And yet, for all that, there is much to be thankful for." Thorstein replied, "It is a chieftain's duty now to look after some arrangement for these men who are without shelter, and to find them food." Eirik answered, "That is an ever true saying. You know not until you have got your answer. I will now take thy counsel about this. All those who had no other abodes were to go with the father and the son. Then came they to land and went forth home. Now after this, I have to tell you about how Thorstein, Eirik's son, began wooing Gudrid, Thorbjorn's daughter. To his proposals a favorable answer was given, both by the maid herself and also by her father. The marriage was also arranged, so that Thorstein went to take possession of his bride, and the bridal feast was held at Brattahlid in the autumn. The banquet went off well and was numerously attended. Thorstein owned a homestead in the Vestrabygd on the estate known as Lysufjordr, the Shining Firth. The man who was called Thorstein owned the other half of the homestead. His wife was called Sigrid. Thorstein went, during the autumn, to Lysufjordr, to his namesake, both he and Gudrid. The reception was a welcome one. They were there during the winter. When little of the winter was past, the event happened there, that fever broke out on their estate. The overseer of the work was named Garth. He was an unpopular man. He took the fever first and died. Afterwards, and with but little intermission, one took the fever after another and died. Then Thorstein, Eirik's son, fell ill, and also Sigrid, the wife of his namesake Thorstein. And one evening, Sigrid left the house and rested a while opposite the outer door. And Gudrid accompanied her, and they looked back towards the outer door, and Sigrid screamed out loud. Gudrid said, "We have come forth unwarily, and thou canst in no wise withstand the cold. Let us even go home as quickly as possible." "It is not safe as matters are," answered Sigrid. "There is all that crowd of dead people before the door. Thorstein, thy husband also, and myself, I recognize among them, and it is a grief thus to behold." "And when this passed away," she said, "let us go now, Gudrid. I see the crowd no longer." Thorstein, Eirik's son, had also disappeared from her sight, and he seemed to have a whip in his hand, and to wish to smite the ghostly troop. Afterwards they went in, and before morning came, she was dead, and a coffin was prepared for her body. At the same day, the men proposed to go out fishing, and Thorstein led them to the landing places, and in the early morning he went to see what they had caught. Then Thorstein, Eirik's son, sent word to his namesake to come to him, saying that matters of home were hardly quiet, that the housewife was endeavoring to rise to her feet and to get under the clothes beside him. And when he was come in, she had risen upon the edge of the bed. Then took he her by the hands and laid a pole axe upon her breast. Thorstein, Eirik's son, died near nightfall. Thorstein the Franklin begged Gudrid to lie down and sleep, saying that he would watch over the body during the night. So she did, and when a little of the night was past, Thorstein, Eirik's son, sat up and spake, saying he wished Gudrid to be called to him, and that he wished to speak with her. "God wills," he said, "that this hour be given to me for my own, and the further completion of my plan." Thorstein the Franklin went to find Gudrid and waked her, begged her to cross herself and to ask God for help, and told her what Thorstein, Eirik's son, had spoken with him. "And he wishes," said he, "to meet with thee. Thou art obliged to consider what plan thou wilt adopt, because I can in this issue advise thee in no wise. She answered, It may be that this wonderful thing has regard to certain matters which are afterwards to be had in memory, and I hope that God's keeping will test upon me, and I will, with God's grace, undertake the risk and go to him, and know what he will say. For I shall not be able to escape if harm must happen to me. I am far from wishing that he should go elsewhere. I suspect, moreover, that the matter will be a pressing one. Then went Gudrid and saw Thorstein. He appeared to her as if shedding tears. He spake in her ear in a low voice, certain words which she alone might know. But this he said so that all heard, that those men would be blessed who held the true faith, and that all salvation and mercy accompanied it, and that many, nevertheless, held it lightly. It is, said he, no good custom which has prevailed here in Greenland since Christianity came, to bury men in unconsecrated ground with few religious rites over them. I wish for myself, and for those other men who have died, to be taken to the church. But for Garth, I wish him to be burned on a funeral pyre as soon as may be, for he is the cause of all those ghosts which have been among us this winter. He spake to Gudrid also about her own state, saying that her destiny would be a great one, and begged her to beware of marrying Greenland men. He begged her also to pay over their property to the church, and some to the poor, and then he sank down for the second time. It had been a custom in Greenland, after Christianity was brought there, to bury men in unconsecrated ground on the farms where they died. An upright stake was placed over a body, and when the priests came afterwards to the place, then was the stake pulled out, consecrated water poured therein, and a funeral service held, though it might be long after the burial. The bodies were removed to the church in Eiriksfjordr, and funeral services held by the priests. After that, died Thorbjorn. The whole property then went to Gudrid. Eirik received her into his household, and looked well after her stores. There was a man named Thorfinn Karlsefni, son of Thord Horsehead, who dwelt in the north of Iceland, at Reynins in Skagafjordr, as it is now called. Karlsefni was a man of good family, and very rich. His mother's name was Thorun. He engaged in trading journeys, and seemed a goodly, bold, and gallant traveler. One summer, Karlsefni prepared his ship, intending to go to Greenland. Snorri, Thorbrand's son, from Alptafjordr, resolved to travel with him, and there were 30 men in the company. There was a man named Bjarni, Grimolf's son, a man of Breidafjordr, or Broadfirth, another called Thorhall, son of Gamli, a man from the east of Iceland. They prepared their ship the very summer as Karlsefni, with intent also to go to Greenland. They had in their ship 40 men. The two ships launched out into the open sea as soon as they were ready. It is not recorded how long a voyage they had, but after this, I have to tell you that both of these ships came to Eiriksfjordr about autumn. Eirik rode down to the ships with the other men of the land, and a market fair was promptly instituted. The captains invited Gudrid to take such of the merchandise as she wished, and Eirik displayed on his part much magnificence in return, inasmuch as he invited both these ships' companies home with him to pass the winter in Brattahlid. The merchants accepted the invitation and went home with Eirik. Afterwards, their merchandise was removed to Brattahlid, where a good and large outhouse was not lacking in which to store the goods. The merchants were well pleased to stay with Eirik during the winter. When now Yule was drawing nigh, Eirik began to look more gloomy than he was wont to be. Presently, Karlsefni entered into conversation with him and said, Art thou in trouble, Eirik? It appears to me that thou art somewhat more taciturn than thou hast been. Still thou helpest us with much liberality, and we are bound to reward thee according as we have means thereto. Say now, what causes thy cheerlessness? Erik answered, You receive hospitality well, and like worthy men. Now I have no mind that our intercourse together should be expensive to you. But so it is, that it will seem to me an ill thing if it is heard, that you never spent a worse Yule than this. Just now beginning, when Erik the Red entertained you at Brattahlid in Greenland. Karlsefni answered, It must not come to such a pass. We have in our ships malt, meal, corn, and you have right and title to take therefrom whatever you wish, and to make your entertainment such consorts with your munificence. And Erik accepted the offer. Then was preparation made for the Yule feast, and so magnificent was it that the men thought they had scarcely ever seen so grand a feast. And after Yule, Karlsefni broached to Erik the subject of a marriage with Gudrid, which he thought might be under Eirik's control. And the woman appeared to him to be both beautiful and of excellent understanding. Erik answered and said that for his part he would willingly undertake his suit, and said moreover that she was worthy of a good match. It is also likely, he thought, that she will be following out her destiny, should she be given to him. And moreover, the report which comes to me of him is good. The proposals were now laid before her, and she allowed the marriage with her to be arranged, which Erik wished to promote. However, I will not speak at length how this marriage took place. The Yule festival was prolonged and made into a marriage feast. Great joy was there in Brattahlid during the winter. Much playing at backgammon and telling of stories went on, and many things were done that ministered to the comfort of the household. During this time, much talk took place in Brattahlid about making ready to go to Vinland the Good, and it was asserted that they would there find good choice lands. The discourse came to such conclusion that Karlsefni and Snorri prepared their ship with the intention of seeking Vinland during the summer. Bjarni and Thorhall ventured on the same expedition with their ship and the retinue which had accompanied them. There was a man named Thorvald. He married Freydis, natural daughter of Erik the Red. He set out with them likewise, as also Thorvald, a son of Erik. There was a man named Thorvald. He was the son-in-law of Erik the Red. Thorhall was called the Sportsman. He had for a long time been Eirik's companion in hunting and fishing expeditions during the summers, and many things had been committed to his keeping. Thorhall was a big man, dark, and of gaunt appearance, rather advanced in years, overbearing in temper, of melancholy mood, silent at times, underhand in his dealings, and withal given to abuse, and always inclined towards the worst. He had kept himself aloof from the true faith when it came to Greenland. He was but little encompassed with the love of friends, but yet Erik had long held conversation with him. He went in the ship with Thorvald and his man, because he was widely acquainted with the unpeopled districts. They had the ship which Thorbjorn had brought to Greenland, and they ventured on the expedition with Karlsefni and the others, but most of them in this ship were Greenlanders. There were 160 men in their ships. They sailed away from land, then to Vesturbygd and to Bjarnjar, the Bear Islands. Thence they sailed away from Bjarnjar, the northerly winds. They were out at sea 2 half days. Then they came to land, and rowed along it in boats, and explored it, and found there flat stones, many and so great, that 2 men might well lie on them, stretched on their backs with heel to heel. Polar foxes were also there in abundance. This land they gave name to, and called it Helluland, or Stone Land. Then they sailed with northerly winds 2 half days, and there was then land before them, and on it a great forest and many wild beasts. An island lay in the southeast off the land, and they found bears thereon, and called the island Bjarni, or Bear Island. But the mainland, where the forest was, they called Markland, or Forest Land. Then, when 2 half days were past, they saw land, and sailed under it. There was a cape to which they came. They cruised along the land, leaving it on the starboard side. There was a harborless coastland and long sandy strands. They went to the land in boats, and found the keel of a ship, and called the place Kjallarnes, or Keelness. They gave also name to the strands, calling them Furdustrandir, or Wondershore, because it was tedious to sail by them. Then the coast became indented with creeks, and they directed their ships along the creeks. Now before this, when Leif was with King Olaf Tryggvason, and the king had requested him to preach Christianity in Greenland, he gave him 2 Scotch people, the man called Haki, and the woman called Hegja. The king requested Leif to have recourse to these people if he should ever want fleetness, because they were swifter than wild beasts. Eirik and Leif had got these people to go with Karlsefni. Now when they had sailed by Furdustrandir, they put the Scotch people on land, and requested them to run into the southern regions, seek for choice land, and come back after 3 half days were past. They were dressed in such wise that they had on the garment which they called Biafal. It was made with a hood at the top, open at the sides without sleeves, and fastened between the legs. A button and a loop held it together there, and elsewhere they were without clothing. Then did they cast anchors from the ships and lay there to wait for them. And when 3 days were expired, the Scotch people leapt down from the land, and one of them had in his hand a bunch of grapes, and another an ear of wild wheat. They said to Karlsefni that they considered they had found good and choice land. Then they received them into their ship, and proceeded on their journey to where the shore was cut into by a firth. They directed the ship within the firth. There was an island lying out in the front of the firth, and there were many great currents around the island, which they called Stromsi, or Stream Island. There were so many birds on it that scarcely was it possible to put one's feet down for the eggs. They continued their course up the firth, which they called Stromsfjordr, and carried their cargo ashore from their ships, and there they prepared to stay. They had with them cattle of all kinds, and for themselves they sought to the produce of the land thereabout. There were mountains, and the place was fair to look upon. They gave no heed to anything except to explore the land, and they found large pastures. They remained there during the winter, which happened to be a hard one, with no work doing, and they were badly off for food, and the fishing failed. Then they went out to the island, hoping that something might be got there from fishing or from what was drifted ashore. In that spot, there was little, however, to be got for food, but their cattle found good sustenance. After that, they called upon God, praying that he would send them some little store of meat. But their prayer was not so soon granted as they were eager that it should be. Thorhall disappeared from sight, and they went to seek him, and sought for 3 half days continuously. On the 4th half day, Karlsefni and Bjarni found him on the peak of a crag. He lay with his face to the sky, with both eyes and mouth and nostrils wide open, clawing and pinching himself and reciting something. They asked why he had come there. He replied that it was of no importance, begged them not to wonder thereat. As for himself, he had lived so long, they needed not take any account of him. They begged him to go home with them, and he did so. A little while after, a whale was driven ashore, and the men crowded round it and cut it up, and still they knew not what kind of whale it was. Even Karlsefni recognized it not, though he had great knowledge of whales. It was cooked by the cook boys, and they ate thereof, though bad effects came upon all from it afterwards. Then began Thorhall and said, "Has it not been that Redbeard has proved a better friend than your Christ? This was my gift for the poetry which I composed about Thor, my patron. Seldom has he failed me." Now when the men knew that, none of them would eat of it, and they threw it down from the rocks and turned with their supplications to God's mercy. Then was granted to them opportunity of fishing, and after that, there was no lack of food that spring. They went back again from the island within Straumsfjordr, and obtained food from both sides, from hunting on the mainland, and from gathering eggs, and from fishing on the side of the sea. When summer was at hand, they discussed about their journey and made an arrangement. Thorhall the sportsman wished to proceed northwards along Furudastrandir and off Kjalarnes, and so seek Vinland. But Karlsefni desired to proceed southwards along the land and away from the east, because the land appeared to him the better the further south he went. And he thought of it also as more advisable to explore in both directions. Then did Thorhall make ready for his journey, out by the islands, and there volunteered for the expedition with him not more than 9 men, but with Karlsefni there went the remainder of the company. And one day, when Thorhall was carrying water to his ship, he drank and recited this verse. "The clashers of weapons did say when I came here, that I should have the best of drink, though it becomes me not to complain before the common people. Eager god of the war helmet, I am made to raise the bucket. Wine has not moistened my beard, rather do I kneel at the fountain." Afterwards they put to sea, and Karlsefni accompanied them by the island. Before they hoisted sail, Thorhall recited a verse. "Go we back where our countrymen are. Let us make the skilled hawk of the sand heaven explore the broad ship courses, while the dauntless rousers of the sword storm, who praise the land and cook whale, dwell on Furudastrandir." Then they left, and sailed northwards along Furudastrandir and Kjalarnes, and attempted there to gain a wind from the west. A gale came upon them, however, and drove them onwards against Ireland, and there they were severely treated, enthralled, and beaten. Then Thorhall lost his life. Karlsefni proceeded southwards along the land with Snorri and Bjarni and the rest of the company. They journeyed a long while, and until they arrived at a river, which came down from the land and fell into a lake, and so on to the sea. There were large islands off the mouth of the river, and they could not come into the river except at high flood tide. Karlsefni and his people sailed to the mouth of the river, and called the land Hop. There they found fields of wild wheat wherever there were low grounds, and the vine in all places where there was rough rising ground. Every rivulet there was full of fish. They made holes where the land and water joined, and where the tide went highest, and when it ebbed, they found halibut in the holes. There was great plenty of wild animals of every form in the wood. They were there half a month, amusing themselves, and not becoming aware of anything. Their cattle they had with them. And early one morning, as they looked around, they beheld 9 canoes made of hides, and snout-like staves were brandished from the boats. They made a noise like flails and twisted around in every direction of the sun's motion. Then Karlsefni said, "What will this betoken?" Snorri answered him, "It may be that it is a token of peace. Let us take a white shield and go to meet them." And so they did. Then did they in the canoes row forwards, and showed surprise at them, and came to land. They were short men, ill-looking, with their hair in disorderly fashion on their heads. They were large-eyed and broad cheeks, and they stayed there a while in astonishment. Afterwards they rowed away to the south, off the headland. They had built their settlements up above the lake, and some of the dwellings were well within land, but some were near the lake. Now they remained there that winter. They had no snow whatever, and all their cattle went out to graze without keepers. Now when the spring began, they beheld one morning early that a fleet of hide canoes was rowing from the south off the headland. So many were they, as if the sea were strewn with pieces of charcoal. And there was also the brandishing of staves, as before, from each boat. Then they held their shields up, and a market was formed between them. And this people, in their purchases, preferred red cloth, in exchange they had furs to give, and skins quite gray. They wished also to buy swords and lances, but Karlsefni and Snorri forbade it. They offered for the cloth dark hides, and took in exchange a span long of cloth, and bound it round their heads, and so matters went on for a while. But when the stock of cloth began to grow small, they split it asunder, so that it was not more than a finger's breadth. The Skraelinger gave for it still quite as much, or more than before. Now it came to pass that a bull, which belonged to Karlsefni's people, rushed out of the woods and bellowed loudly at the same time. The Skraelinger, frightened thereat, rushed away to their canoes and rowed south along the coast. There was then nothing seen of them for 3 weeks together. When that time was gone by, there was seen approaching from the south a great crowd of Skraelinger boats, coming down upon them like a stream. The staves this time being all brandished in the direction opposite the sun's motion, and the Skraelinger were all howling loudly. Then took they and bare red shields to meet them. They encountered one another and fought, and there was a great shower of missiles. The Skraelinger also had war slings or catapults. Then Karlsefni and Snorri see that the Skraelinger are bringing up poles, with a very large ball attached to them, to be compared in size to a sheep's stomach, dark in color, and these flew over Karlsefni's company toward the land, and when they came down they struck the ground with a hideous noise. This produced great terror in Karlsefni and his company, so that their only impulse was to retreat up the country along the river, because it seemed as if crowds of Skraelinger were driving at them from all sides, and they stopped not until they came to certain crags, and there they offered them stern resistance. Freydis came out and saw how they were retreating. She called out, "Why you run away from such worthless creatures, stout men that ye are, when, as seems to me likely, you might slaughter them like so many cattle? Let me but have a weapon. I think I could fight them better than any of you." They gave no heed to what she said. Freydis endeavored to accompany them. Still, she soon lagged behind because she was not well. She went after them into the wood, and the Skraelinger directed their pursuit after her. She came upon a dead man, Thorbrand, Snorri's son, with a flat stone fixed in his head. His sword lay beside him, so she took it up and prepared to defend herself therewith. Then came the Skraelinger upon her. She let down her sark and struck her breast with the naked sword. At this they were frightened, rushed off to their boats, and fled away. Karlsefni and the rest came up to her and praised her zeal. Two of Karlsefni's men fell, and four of the Skraelinger, notwithstanding they had overpowered them by superior numbers. After that they proceeded to their booths, and began to reflect about the crowd of men which attacked them upon the land. It appeared to them now that the one troop will have been that which came in the boats, and the other troop will have been a delusion of sight. The Skraelinger also found a dead man, and his axe lay beside him. One of them struck a stone with it, and broke the axe. It seemed to them good for nothing, as it did not withstand the stone, and they threw it down. Karlsefni and his company were now of opinion that though the land might be choice and good, there would always be war and terror overhanging them from those who dwelt there before them. They made ready, therefore, to move away, with intent to go to their own land. They sailed forth northwards, and found 5 Skraelinger in jackets of skin, sleeping near the sea. And they had with them a chest, and in it was marrow of animals mixed with blood. And they considered that these must have been outlawed. They slew them. Afterwards they came to a headland, and a multitude of wild animals. And this headland appeared as if it might be a cake of cow dung, because the animals passed the winters there. Now they came to Stramsfjordr, where also they had abundance of all kinds. It is said by some that Bjarni and Fedris remained there, and 100 men with them, and went not further away. But Karlsefni and Snorri journeyed southwards, and 40 men with them. and after staying no longer than scarcely 2 months at Hop, had come back the same summer. Karlsefni set out with a single ship to seek Thorhall, but the rest of the company remained behind. He and his people went northwards, off Kjalarnes, and were then borne onwards towards the west, and the land lay on their larboard side, and was nothing but wilderness. And when they had proceeded for a long time, there was a river which came down from the land, flowing from east towards the west. They directed their course within the river's mouth, and lay opposite of the southern bank. One morning, Karlsefni's people beheld, as it were, a glittering speak above the open space in front of them, and they shouted at it. It stirred itself, and it was a being of the race of men that have only one foot. And he came down quickly to where they lay. Thorvald, son of Eirik the Red, sat at the tiller, and the one-footer shot him with an arrow in the lower abdomen. He drew out the arrow. Then said Thorvald, "Good land we have reached, and fat is it above the paunch." Then the one-footer leapt away again northwards. They chased after him, and saw him occasionally, but it seemed as if he would escape them. He disappeared at a certain creek. Then they turned back, and one man spake this ditty. "Our men chased, all true it is, a one-footer down to the shore, but the wonderful man strove hard in the race. Hearken, Karlsefni." Then they journeyed again, away back again northwards, and saw, as they thought, the land of the one-footers. They wished, however, no longer to risk their company. They conjectured the mountains to be all one range, those, that is, which were at Hop, and those which they now discovered, almost answering to one another. And it was in the same distance to them on both sides from Stromsfjordr. They journeyed back, and were in Stromsfjordr the third winter. Then fell the men greatly into backsliding. Those who were wifeless pressed their claims at the hands of those who were married. Snorri, Karlsefni's son, was born the first autumn, and he was 3 winters old when they began their journey home. Now when they sailed from Vinland, they had a southern wind, and reached Markland, and found 5 Skrælinger. One was a bearded man, 2 were women, 2 children. Karlsefni's people caught the children, but the others escaped and sunk down into the earth. And they took the children with them, and taught them their speech, and they were baptized. The children called their mother Veitildi, and their father Uvregi. They said that kings ruled over the land of the Skrælinger, one of them who was called Avaldaman, and the other Valdidada. They said also that there were no houses, and the people lived in caves or holes. They said, moreover, that there was a land on the other side, over against their land, and the people there were dressed in white garments, uttered loud cries, bare long poles, and wore fringes. This was supposed to be the Vitrimana land, the white man's land. Then came they to Greenland, and remained with Eirik the Red during the winter. Bjarni, Grimolf's son, and his men were carried into the Irish Ocean, and came into a part where the sea was infested by shipworms. They did not find it out before the ship was eaten through under them, and they debated what plan they should follow. They had a ship's boat, which was smeared with the tar made of seal fat. It is said that the shipworm would not bore into the wood, which had been smeared with the seal tar. The counsel and advice of most of the men was to ship into the boat as many men as it would hold. Now, when that was tried, the boat held not more than half the men. Then Bjarni advised that it should be decided by the casting of lots, and not by the rank of the men, which of them should go into the boat, inasmuch as every man there wished to go into the boat, though it could not hold all of them. Therefore, they accepted the plan to cast lots, who should leave the ship for the boat. And the lot so fell that Bjarni and nearly half the men with him were chosen for the boat. So then those left the ship and went into the boat who had been chosen by lot to do so. And when the men were come into the boat, a young man, an Icelander, who had been a fellow traveler, Bjarni, said, "Dost thou intend, Bjarni, to separate thyself here from me?" "It must needs be so now," Bjarni answered, "because in such case thou didst not so promise me when I set out from Iceland with thee from the homestead of my father." Bjarni answered, "I do not, however, see any other plan, but what plan dost thou suggest?" He replied, "I propose this plan, that we two make a change in our places, and thou come here, and I will go there," Bjarni answered. "So shall it be, and this I say, that thou laborest willingly for life, and that it seems to thee a grievous thing to face death." Then they changed places. The man went into the boat, and Bjarni back into the ship. And it is said that Bjarni perished there in the Worm Sea, and they who were with him in the ship. But the boat and those who were in it went on their journey until they reached land and told the story afterwards. The next summer, Karlsefni set out for Iceland, and Snorri with him, and went home to his house in Reynings. His mother considered that he had made a shabby match, and she was not at home the first winter. But when she found that Gudrid was a lady without peer, she went home, and their intercourse was happy. The daughter of Snorri, Karlsefni's son, was Hallfrid, mother of Bishop Thorlak, the son of Runolf. Hallfrid and Runolf had a son, whose name was Thorbjorn. His daughter was Thorun, mother of Bishop Bjarn. Thorgeir was the name of a son of Snorri, Karlsefni's son. He was father of Yngvild, the mother of the first Bishop Brand. And here ends the story. Thank you for listening to this saga. Please let me know which historical writings you would like to hear me read next. Leave your comments down below, and don't forget to subscribe. It really helps me out a lot. And don't forget to subscribe if you find this content interesting. For Nordhugger, this is Matt. Thank you.